So I'll start with another introduction. I'll keep it brief this time. So I am Ishan Roy. I work as a consultant with the government of Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu is one of the largest states in India in terms of population. It's also one of the most advanced in terms of digital penetration. So smartphone penetration is very high. Penetration of broadband internet is very high. It's one of the leaders when it comes to implementing technology within citizen service delivery in the country and compared to the other state governments of India. I help the government implement blockchain citizen service delivery and build a more secure cross-departmental workflows, cross-organizational workflows. I help them to secure government-issued documents such as education certificates, licenses, etc. And I help them plan their roadmap, their strategy, how they plan to bring in this revolutionary technology within the e-governance structure. A brief history of how I got into the space and where I've been working before I got to the state of Tamil Nadu. So I started working in blockchain in the year 2017. I was working with ICICI Bank, which is India's largest private sector lender. And I had the opportunity to be on a team that carried out one of the first banking blockchain remittance transactions around the world. And this was the first in India at that time. So we worked there a couple of years, me and my co-workers. We built a platform and then we quit to start up a venture called Hashcash Consultants. Through Hashcash, me and my team members built a lot of fintech products on enterprise blockchain as well as public blockchains for clients around the world. So we built such as Bitcoin to fiat payment gateways, cryptocurrency exchanges, market makers. We built a cross-border remittance platforms, etc., leveraging blockchain technology. And around 3 years back, I started working with the state government of Tamil Nadu. Parallelly, I'm also a blockchain author. My book, Blockchain Development for Financial Projects, is available through Amazon as well as PactPub. I am also a member of the expert panel of the EU Blockchain Observatory and forum where I author various reports and I help them review various trend reports on blockchain. So that's a brief introduction about myself. Let's get to the session for today. So today's session would be like a high-level scanner of how blockchain has evolved in the space of e-governance. I'll be talking more about projects and initiatives rather than technology within this presentation. The idea is to give someone who is trying to build a product for governments in the blockchain space or someone who's working with the government and they're trying to figure out how to introduce blockchain. The idea is to give you a flavor of where we are coming from, what we are doing right now, and how e-governance and blockchain is evolving in the future, right? So this is a brief presentation flow. We'll start with seeing why do governments, which are arguably one of the most centralized organizations, why do they need a decentralized technology like blockchain? We'll talk a little bit about how the adoption of blockchain within the e-governance structure has evolved from a focus on use cases to platforms and infrastructure and building technology stacks. We'll talk a little bit about how, apart from a user of blockchain technology, government can also be an enabler for blockchain and build a blockchain ecosystem which will help the adoption of the technology. And we'll talk a little bit about implementation and popular case studies from around the world. So let's start with an interesting question. Why do governments really need blockchain, right? So anyone who is even a little versed with this technology, you would realize that this technology focuses on decentralization and distribution. So why would an organization that's arguably the most centralized entity, why would it be interested in a technology like this? The answer really lies in the problem that blockchain solves. If you look at how processes are being carried out today, right? So over the last few decades and in India over the last decade, we have seen a transformation of processes going from paper-based to digital processes. There are certain benefits that digital processes have, which is that they require less storage space. It's easy to move them. They are portable. It's less expensive to maintain them, but they require certain specialized skills, etc. However, there are certain benefits that paper-based processes have that digital processes have still not been able to overcome or have still not been able to solve. So for example, if I have digitized data residing somewhere, unless I don't use a special software, I can alter it very easily and I will not leave an audit trail behind. If let's say I am keeping someone's land title records or land registry records in a centralized database, it can very easily be modified and there's no way someone would come to know that this change has happened. This is especially true if, let's say, you might have like a rogue employee or even if, let's say, a hacker manages to get access to your infrastructure. Apart from that, there are certain benefits that paper-based processes give you. For example, if I write on paper, it's immutable. It stays there for time to come, right? So there's an audit record. If you will see, that a lot of government processes still have a component that continues to be paper-based because they want to maintain that audit trail on paper. So what blockchain is really doing and how it is helping in the government space is that it allows you to bring the benefits of paper-based processes, which are basically immutability, auditability, maintaining an audit trail, etc., to digitize data, which is essential for a lot of data that governments deal with. So specifically, what are the problems that it solves or what are the solutions that blockchain provides? So the first is non-repudiation of digitized data. So be it education certificates or licenses or receipts, if a government is issuing these to an external party, there might be cases where someone can challenge the integrity of the data or the authenticity of the data, given that it's residing in a centralized database. Or we have had cases where a certain malicious party has gotten access to a centralized database owned by the government and they may have changed some records, right? So how blockchain helps the government is it helps them establish non-repudiation of digitized data, something we have not been able to do with digital certificates in a foolproof manner until now. This is also really important when you are trying to create processes or workflows between various departments. So I'm not sure how land registry works in other parts of the world, but in India, the land registry transaction is maintained on ledger that is owned by a department, let's call it Department A, whereas the transfer of title for land is done by another department, which is Department B. So in an ideal digitized world, even if these two ledgers are maintained by two departments, for the end customer, which is the citizen, there should be one process where you go, you register a land transaction and immediately you get the title, the ownership of the land as well. But in the real world, it doesn't happen like that. What happens is you go, you apply to the first department, they will register your transaction digitally, then give you a paper receipt. You take it to the second department, you hand it to them, and then the ownership change happens, right? So the reason for that is because they really want that audit trail to be maintained and they really want the citizen to be engaged so that tomorrow no one can challenge this transfer of title. So for cross-departmental flows like this, for inter-entity flows like this, for example, transaction between two state governments, you really need to have a way to so that non-repudiation of this digitized data can be established. And this is where blockchain plays one of the biggest roles in government. So using this, you can build more futuristic service delivery mechanisms. The second is asset tracking and auditability. So assets can vary. These could range from anything such as defense assets, right, to, let's say, benefits distributed by the government, let's say, rice, wheat, or any food packages distributed by the government. This could be, let's say, some IT peripherals that are distributed by the government. So there can be a large range of assets that the government is moving around either between its own entities or it's delivering to the citizen. And blockchain can help establish provenance for all these assets across various entities and ensure last mile delivery. So that's another problem that blockchain solves. And that's another use case where blockchain can play a big role. Third is risk mitigation, internal and external. So let's go back to the land registration or the land title registration example that I was talking about. If let's say you are dealing with a centralized database where you are maintaining the list of the ownership of all land that exists in a certain district or in a certain state, if let's say a rogue employee is there or a rogue vendor is there, they could very easily go and change the record and then the citizen would be at the mercy of the centralized database or whatever is the owner that is established by the centralized database. There's no way to check whether the data was changed. There's no audit trail as such by default. So in this cases, blockchain helps to mitigate the internal risks from such parties. There could be external risks as well, which I'm sure you're aware of, which can be hackers or people from outside trying to change data, etc. And fourth, and probably one of the most interesting ones, is that blockchain helps us to build better privacy-preserving mechanisms, which becomes all the more important when you're doing digital service delivery and you're dealing with sensitive data such as healthcare data, financial data, etc. Right? So how do you build more secure identities that can be controlled by the citizen? How do you ensure that consent mechanisms are better and they are faster? Right, so how do you do all that? And that is where blockchain plays a big role. Okay, so now that's broadly the type of use cases where blockchain can help. Now let's see what are the applications, right? So when you talk about securing digitized data, just give me a minute. Okay, so when you talk about securing digital artifacts and data, so what are the applications where blockchain can play a big role, right? So some of the examples where blockchain has already been implemented or people are thinking about implementing is on certificates, licenses, receipts, government documents that are shared between various entities. One of the interesting use cases is, can we use blockchain for tracking website defacement very early on, right? So you have cases where a certain government website may be tampered by a hacker and the authorities may not get to know until an hour or two later. So can we use blockchain over here to immediately track when a website is defaced? In terms of provenance and traceability, we can use it for benefits distribution, for tracking the benefits that are being given by governments to citizens in the form of scholarships or, let's say, disaster relief, or let's say right now something that's very relevant is COVID allowance, etc. You can use it to track land ownership, title transfers, for tracking defense supply chains. You can track it to use it to track spurious drugs. You can use it for trading energy units on energy grids, for enabling microfinance at a fraction of the cost, and definitely one of the more popular use cases, CBDCs. You can also use it for interoperability and reconciliation. And this comes into play where you have interdepartmental or cross-departmental workflows. So for example, for passport verification, typically you need to go to 2-3 authorities or 2-3 entities to get a passport issued to the citizen. So instead of the citizen going back and forth, you can have the entire process on a blockchain where it is tracked and all the parties are able to verify the background information and issue passport easily. Same can be done for property plans. So property plans typically require 2-3 regulators to sign off on the plans. So for example, a local body might be there, the fire and safety department might be there, etc. So for such workflows, blockchain is a perfect companion to solve any associated issues or problems. You can also talk about schemes and services delivery and auditability and deduplicated data. So the last one is something that's a problem that plagues a lot of state governments in India. So because a lot of our names are given in native languages and ultimately a lot of record keeping is done in English, you have an issue where a lot of native names, when they are translated to English, they might have different spellings. They might be spelled in a different manner. So which leads to a lot of duplicate records across various government entities and departments. So one of the interesting things that blockchain can do is it can help you maintain a golden record of such citizen data so that you don't have duplication or you don't have confusion or you don't have the government issuing double benefits to the same citizen just because the spelling is wrong or the name is wrong, etc. And lastly, like I mentioned, for identity and privacy, for issuing blockchain issued driving licenses, land documents, passports, figuring out self-sovereign identity where a citizen controls what data can be shared with which entities, and they have complete control over their identity, to consent management in sense of GDPR and for implementing privacy preserving workflows. So these are areas where governments can leverage blockchain. Okay, so now moving on, let's talk a little bit about how blockchain has evolved in the e-governance space. So prior to 2019, so from 2017 to 2019 or mid 2019, when governments really started getting into blockchain and you know, they were starting to explore how this technology can make a difference, one of the few of the projects that we saw, they would always focus on a certain use case. So governments initially didn't really understand the technology as well as the crypto sector, or as well as the developers who were working on public blockchains. Obviously, the people who they were talking to, how they understood it is that they understood that this is a this is a technology that can be used to solve specific use cases. And every time I need to solve a use case, I will go and I'll deploy a blockchain, I'll solve that problem, and then I'll move on to a next problem. So 2017, you have a few of the very early blockchain projects. So you have Georgia using the Bitcoin blockchain for issuing land titles. Similarly, Sweden and Ukraine were also trying to do something similar with blockchain. They were also trying to do POCs around issuing land titles and transferring land titles on blockchain. On the same lines, the city of Amravati in India, it also tried to do land registry in the year 2018 on blockchain. Meanwhile, in Zug, Switzerland, they were experimenting with how do we issue decentralized identity to the people who had settled in Zug. And if you know about Zug, it's popularly known as Crypto Village. It has a lot of blockchain startups. So they started using a platform called Uport, which was basically an identity platform built on blockchain. And they would issue a residential proof, and they would give you rights for voting on blockchain. So it was a decentralized identity, again, solving a single use case. Singapore was also doing interesting things. So there was a very successful project, which is still running, called Open Search, implementing in 2017. And they started to give their undergraduate certificates on blockchain and anchor it on the public Ethereum blockchain. Parallelly, MAS, the Monetary Authority of Singapore, they started a project called Project Ubin, and they tried out various payment POCs, and they have five phases that are running. Currently, phase 1 to 4 were implemented till 2019, and their focus was on domestic payment, building payment tokens, building cross-border payment platforms, etc. They were trying various POCs with various consortiums. Delaware, meanwhile, was doing something very interesting. So Delaware, I'm sure a lot of you from the States would be aware, is popular for the number of companies and startups that are registered there. So they were seeing if they can maintain an audit trail for corporate filings in blockchain. So you would notice all of these are individual use cases. They were trying to solve just one problem. Few others, for example, Malta was trying to solve the problem of spurious academic credentials with block certs. Bank of Canada was running a project called Project Jasper that focused on payments. So these were really isolated proof of concepts and pilots where they were experimenting with the technology, and they were seeing, does it solve one single problem? Can it solve one single problem? The only notable exception in all these POCs before 2019 is the platform that was implemented by Estonia. So it's implemented using something called KSI blockchain. Right, so KSI stands for keyless blockchain, or KSI something. What they were doing is they were trying to use a technology that was not exactly blockchain in the sense that it didn't have blocks. It relied a lot on computer hashes rather than proof of work or consensus or the other blockchain concepts that you are well versed with. And they were using this system to secure government data and logs. And we'll see how this has evolved. But it was more of a general purpose use case. It was not specified to solving one problem. So briefly, just to summarize how things were going before 2019, the focus was on individual use cases. Most of these platforms were forked versions of public blockchain stacks, like a fork of Bitcoin or a fork of Ethereum. And the reason being that at this point of time, enterprise blockchain had not really evolved to a point where it could be used for production implementation. In fact, one of the first projects I worked on that was also a fork of the Bitcoin platform. Consortium formation would typically happen on the basis of the use case. So for example, if you look at the open search initiative by Singapore, it would focus only on colleges or academic institutions and would not go beyond that. So for example, they would not consider student loans or scholarships. They would just talk about academic credentials. Typically, it would have a centralized infrastructure. So a lot of these use cases had 5 or 6 nodes that were deployed in the same data center, or in some cases, even within the same physical server. And it's not really how blockchain is meant to be implemented, right? It's not distributed. It's not decentralized. It's basically just doing blockchain for the sake of doing blockchain. And they were not really scalable in terms of how many use cases you can implement, and also not in terms of what kind of implementations can be done with these platforms. And the extendability was not much. So with something like the land registration implementation in Andhra Pradesh, you could probably just track land titles. You could not do much more than that, right? And so from mid-2019 or to early 2019, governments began to evolve and really started to understand how this technology needed to be implemented. Happened because the crypto space was evolving, and pre-2019 and pre-2017 really, crypto was more underground, but in 2019-2018, it became slightly mainstream. So people were starting to understand this technology. It did not have the negative image that it had in the previous image, and so in the previous years. And so the way the technology would be implemented really started to mature. And these platforms are what are laying the road or the strategy for the future. So EU, it's called European Blockchain Service Infrastructure, which is abbreviated to EBSI. They have started with 4 categories of use cases. So something these governments realize is that if you really want to build a scalable, extendable blockchain use case or a blockchain implementation, and you want to build something that really benefits the citizen and will survive for years to come, instead of focusing on simple use cases, what you do is you shortlist the use cases you want to target. You figure out what are the reusable components or the technical modules between these platforms, and then you build a generic platform that can be used across multiple applications and also have some synergy or interconnectivity between them. So EBSI started with 4 categories of use cases, and we'll discuss what these 4 were. And similarly, Singapore broadened its open search project. So instead of open search, this project has now evolved to something called open attestation, and it can be used to notarize all kind of documents, not just education certificates. Similarly, Estonia's KSI project also evolved. So now it is used to secure a number of registries owned by the Estonia government, such as it is used for securing the voting ledger, identity registration, company registration, property registration, blockchain, etc. So because it was a generic platform, it was able to expand much beyond a single use case. Similarly, in India, we have a regulator called the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, which basically monitors all the telecom companies of India. They also implemented a DLT network across all the telecom regulators for tracking spam calls and spam messages and restricting marketing messages. And they are exploring whether this can be used for mobile to mobile payments, etc. Few other prominent examples. So if you look at Blockchain Dubai and you see how they are implementing blockchain, they also have a generic approach where they are not limiting themselves to 3 or 4 use cases. They're going for an approach that will enable a lot of use cases. LACchain from Latin America is following a similar approach, as is National Blockchain Australia. You have a lot of private consortiums that are being formed around a similar idea, such as IBM Food Chain, Mediledger, TradeLens is a supply chain platform called by Maersk, where the focus is mostly on the industry vertical that you are trying to work with, not really on the single use case, right? So they are trying to enable multiple use cases. In MaaS in Singapore, Project Ubin evolved to phase 5, where they are now looking and trying to see how can we build a broad payment ecosystem that takes care of multiple use cases. Two other examples from India. So one is NISG blockchain strategy paper. So this is a paper that was issued by the Ministry of IT in India, where they talked about building a national blockchain platform for the governments of India. And within Tamil Nadu, we are trying to build something called NambiKNM, which is a Tamil language translation of blockchain. And we are trying to build a similar general purpose platform, which can be used by all the departments within the Tamil Nadu government. So what are some of the key points in this era or this evolution that happened, right? So the focus, whenever these governments were trying to design a platform, was on synergies. So what is common to the problems I want to solve? What is common to the technical implementations? Can I have reusable microservices? Can I have reusable modules? And the focus was more on network effects. So rather than building like a private blockchain, or rather a private implementation, where you would restrict who could join, they would try to see, okay, how can I build it in a manner where I can invite other participants from other government entities, from the private sector, I can invite startups, etc. Right? So instead of closing in, they opened up. A lot of these platforms are also coupled with policy making and a long-term strategy or a long-term roadmap. So EBSI has issued its blockchain policy. We have issued our policy. A national blockchain in Australia has also issued a policy paper, because they realize that what they really have to do is not just build a platform, they have to build an ecosystem around that platform so that it sustains and you end up with a thriving environment or ecosystem which will benefit other players as well as the government, and it will sustain for years to come. It won't be a technology implementation that dies in a few years or that gets replaced in a few years. These platforms are also technology agnostic, or they were looking at multi-stack support. So for example, if you look at EBSI, EBSI supports Hyperledger Besu and Hyperledger Fabric, so which is flavors of like an enterprise Ethereum and an enterprise Hyperledger Fabric. And when these platforms are being designed, they're not really thinking what are the limitations of the blockchain platform that I want to work with, or which blockchain platform will I work with, and accordingly I'll design the platform. What they are really trying to do is they're trying to design a platform which will solve their, work in correlation with their long-term strategy. And if required, they are okay with using multiple stacks. They are not restricting themselves to a single stack. In fact, they are also open to using public blockchains, especially in the case of auditability, because with private permission blockchains, since the number of nodes are limited, it might be easy to bring the network down. Whereas if, let's say, I'm able to run a private blockchain for the implementation of the application and I use a public blockchain for anchoring the data, that gives me a more secure blockchain. So a few examples, if you see what Singapore is doing. Singapore is anchoring the education certificates and other documents that they are securing with the open attestation project on the Ethereum public blockchain. Similarly, I think EU is also exploring using public blockchains. In India, the state government of Maharashtra, which is another large state in India, they have issued vaccine certificates on blockchain and they're anchoring it on a public blockchain, which is Polygon. So they are following a hybrid approach and they're not tying themselves to a technology stack. One of the interesting things about this approach is that instead of focusing on a single use case and building a single solution, they're trying to build reusable modules for application development. So, for example, something like education certificates would be very similar to how something like, let's say, licenses, driving licenses would be implemented, or let's say something like, receipts for warehouse would be implemented. So what they try to do is, instead of trying to build a single use case, they try to identify the steps in each use case and build reusable modules, which can quickly be implemented or can be deployed to build a solution, and thus cutting down their development at their testing cost. And there's a lot of focus on ecosystem development. So all of these platforms, you'll see they talk about sandboxes, they talk about building SDKs and letting the developers use them. there's a lot of focus on capacity building in terms of training, in terms of teaching developers how to use the SDK. And obviously, there's also a little focus on updating the regulatory framework so that smart contracts are legal in certain sense. Seeing if, let's say, crypto can be introduced in a certain way without using it as an instrument for payment, etc. So there's a lot of ecosystem development also that happens around such platforms. So let's quickly look at what the architecture of one of these platforms looks like. So for reference, I'm looking at EBSI. So EBSI, these two pages are from the EBSI charter. So right away, you will notice that it talks about cooperation between the European Commission and countries in the European blockchain partnership. And they support multiple use cases. So again, there's a discussion about supporting numerous use cases rather than one use case. So these are the four use cases that their sandbox is hosted with right now. But you will notice that the components, the underlying components are reusable and they can be used for various other applications as well. So you have notarization for auditing purposes over blockchain. You can be issued certificates and diplomas on blockchain. You have the self-sovereign identity framework on the EBSI platform. And you have trusted data sharing between entities, again, using blockchain as an anchor. And these are some of the other use cases that they are considering. And you will see there's a broader roadmap. This is something that was missing from the early 2019 use cases. At that time, they were just trying to solve one problem. They did not have an ambition or a roadmap. So here you will see EBSI is talking about enhancing citizen and enterprise mobility. So let's say someone who studies in Belgium, if he moves over to another country in EU, can he carry his diplomas with himself? And when he presents them for a job, can they be verified with the blockchain? So use cases like this. Make more paperless processes and make it easier for people to apply for various services without carrying their documents, ensure compliance with EU regulations, etc. So for example, implementing GDPR, implementing the right to forget, things like that. So there's a clear strategy when this is being implemented, which is largely different from how other technologies or how conventional technology is implemented by governments. So this is a very high level architecture for the EBSI platform. So just start from the bottom where it says number three core infrastructure. So you will notice the core infrastructure is made up of the components that build up this platform. So here you have Besu and Fabric smart contracts. So Hyperledger Besu and Hyperledger Fabric are two different popular enterprise blockchain platforms. And they're saying that you can have like a family or a suite of smart contracts over here. You can have different ledger protocols, meaning different blockchains. A block explorer is a utility that allows you to view transactions across different blockchains. You can have distributed storage off-chain, such as MongoDB, IPFS, etc. So this is the fundamental layer on top of which this platform is built, essentially meaning the blockchain platforms, the tech stacks or protocols on top of which you are building. Underlying that, you also have the infrastructure layer with Docker containers, orchestration, etc. This is the most interesting part and the number three part, the top of the number three and the number two, in my opinion. So over here, you will see that they are trying to extend these microservices or these modules that solve very specific purposes. So for example, here you have a section that is cordoned off called identity. And within that, you will see there are a set of APIs with a specific purpose. So for example, this is a verifiable presentation API, DID API, Identity Hub API, EBSI DID authentication, etc. So meaning that these are APIs that are related just to identity, which can be used for building various applications, etc. Similarly, you have a wallet API here, presumably dealing with the wallet for a citizen, wallet services for a citizen, and some other APIs. Number two, you will say, which says use cases, what they're trying to do is they're trying to see what are the reusable use cases across my implementations. So you have like a wallet web client, you have self-sovereign identity, you have like a diploma module, you have notarization. So a wallet web client can hold an identity, it can hold some EU currency like a digital euro, it can hold your certificates, it can hold some passport details, etc. So it can be like a multi-purpose client used across various implementations. Similarly, self-sovereign identity can be applicable across various implementations. Notarization is another use case. So notarization could be for registering a startup. Notarization could be for registering your education certificates by your chancellor, etc., etc. And lastly, on top of this, you have the application layer where people are using these modules to build applications on top. So for example, if I wanted to build an application for carrying education certificates across the EU in a portable manner, I will use the wallet web client, I will use the self-sovereign identity, diploma and notarization, right? Or if there's another use case, I can pick and choose the modules I want, and on top of it, I can build a presentation layer and some basic business logic for building an application. So it's a very holistic approach to how blockchain is being implemented. Lastly, just one more thing in the architecture. So one of the common arguments or one of the common points of contention that comes against government blockchains or private permission blockchains is that if, let's say, all the parties who are holding the nodes are government entities or they are private sector companies, etc., how can a common citizen ensure that the data is not tampered? Because they can obviously collude and change the data, right? So if you're using blockchain, you need to have a foolproof system that cannot be tampered at all. So there are a couple of ways that these government blockchains do that. So like I mentioned earlier, in the case of Open Search or Open Attestation, which is a Singapore implementation, they basically take the hashes and the Merkle root and they anchor it on a public blockchain. So Open Search actually has smart contracts that are deployed on the public Ethereum network, and the hashes and the Merkle root of the certificates are actually fired as transaction on the public Ethereum blockchain. All the data resides outside the public blockchain. There are other cases. So for example, a lot of government implementations try to leverage a public blockchain and they take a Merkle root of the transactions carried out within a certain time window, such as a day, a week, or a month, and they anchor it on a public blockchain just so that if tomorrow even a single transaction is changed, the Merkle root of the private blockchain will not match the one that was deployed to the public blockchain. So the citizen will know that some fraud has happened and this ledger cannot be trusted. So there are a few examples of this. So the state of Maharashtra is doing this. I believe a few other governments are doing something similar to this. The last and something very interesting that Estonia is doing is something called a widely witnessed event. So what they do is that at the end of a certain time window, so let's say a week or a day, they will take all the transactions that are carried out, calculate a Merkle root, which is like a computer hash containing some details about all the transactions carried out in that window, and take that Merkle root and publish it in all the newspapers of their country. The rationale behind that is that if once we have published this Merkle root to all the newspapers of our country, they cannot go and change back the data. So if there's some transaction that has been tampered on the government ledger, immediately the citizen can check the newspaper and calculate the Merkle root of the transactions and find out that there's a mismatch, right? So this is called a widely witnessed event. It's a very interesting way of bringing in immutability to a private government blockchain. So this was about what's happening right now, how governments are implementing a blockchain as a platform or as an ecosystem. Furthermore, to really build an ecosystem around blockchain, something that governments have realized is important, they have been carrying out a few steps, and you will find these six steps across any blockchain policy you pick up. So the first is there are discussions about common networks and shared infrastructure, which is the blockchain platform that we were talking about. Say they want to build a platform, they want to let these SDKs to startups and developers so that they can build applications. They want other government entities to come and build applications. So they all of them have this similar thought. And you will see that as you read more and more policies, more and more governments understand that in the future, there'll be a realm outside of the tangible one, which mostly in the crypto space or in the IT space, we call as metaverse. So even governments on some level understand that there'll be a metaverse in the future. And even they want in on the action. They also want a platform where people will come and build applications, because they realize that as the de facto trusted parties for so long, they have a clear lead, right? people will want to use their platform, especially enterprises. Second is updating laws and regulations so they understand a lot of the existing frameworks, legal frameworks, and regulatory requirements, etc. will have to be evolved to be compatible with blockchain. So, you know, while there are IT policies that still talk about digital signatures and public and private keys, they still don't talk about smart contracts. They talk about electronic contracts. So governments are figuring out how to introduce arbitration. In fact, we are already seeing certain courts. So for example, in China, you have these internet courts that are using blockchain forensic evidence in various cases as, you know, as some as acceptable proof submitted for a case. Third is startups and industry focused policy. So this I think is universal. Everyone is trying to attract startups and build ecosystems, enable industries. Fourth is being building standards and ethics. So standards in terms of technical standards that work with their existing legacy systems and also interoperate with any future international or global blockchains or public blockchains. And also from an ethical point of view. So what should be okay to do on a blockchain, right? What sort of applications they're okay hosting on their platforms, etc. Fifth is capability building. So training citizens, training existing resources, companies, organizations, startups to be well-versed with this technology. And lastly, cooperative development. So in the case of EBSI, EBSI has just built a sandbox with these four use cases. And they are now running an initiative called Onto Chain, where they're inviting startups to come and build on top of that platform. So similarly, in the case of Singapore, you must have heard of something called the Global CBDC Challenge that MAS is running, where they're inviting startups and companies to come and pitch a solution for building a digital Singapore dollar. So these are broadly the six ways that governments are trying to be a blockchain enabler. Okay, so coming to the last section, and after this, I can summarize and we can take the questions and answers. So what does the road ahead look like? So what are governments looking at in the future? So there are primarily three use cases that come to mind, and I'll slightly expand on this. The first is CBDCs. For those who don't know, CBDC stands for Central Bank Digital Currency. So think of these as cryptocurrencies or digital assets that are issued by a government. So like they print fiat money, they will also issue these crypto tokens or these currencies on a digital ledger that may or may not be secured by blockchain. But in most cases that we are seeing, these reside on a blockchain ledger. So this is one of the more popular use cases, and we'll talk a little bit about the governments that are experimenting with this. Second is secure identities and consent management. So more and more privacy is becoming a concern every day. Obviously, EU has been a leader in the space of privacy. They are now exploring self-sovereign identities, but other governments are also exploring self-sovereign identities and whether they can use advanced cryptography, zero knowledge proof, etc. for protecting the data of their citizen, capture consent better, etc. And last is something that is more of a personal opinion, but I have been hearing this around the place. So again, since NFTs are very popular now, a lot of governments and a lot of technology companies that work with governments are trying to extend this idea to patents, to land titles, to vehicle registration, etc. So let's just briefly look at these three topics. So with respect to CBDCs, they can be of two types. They can be wholesale or retail. And these are obviously mostly conceptual till now, but we have seen a few implementations. So wholesale CBDC is one where you issue a digital asset which can be used by private and public sector entities for settling between themselves. So these are referred to as wholesale CBDCs. Retail CBDCs are issued by the central bank, but they can be used directly by the citizens. So this is a very disruptive take on how money is created today, because today, if you look at how traditional fiat is issued, there's a bank in between and citizens typically get access to currency through a retail bank. However, this retail CBDC model threatens to disrupt the existing way of money issuing at its core. So these are again a few models that have been explored. China has actually been experimenting with retail CBDCs. A few CBDCs have actually come out and they have been implemented. Probably the first and one of the most popular one is a CBDC app or a payment platform called Bakong, which was built by Cambodia. And just yesterday, they have announced that they are now experimenting with Maybank of Malaysia to see if they can use it for cross-border remittance as well. ECNY or Digital Yuan or eRenminbi is built by China, and they have been using it extensively. In fact, there were stories that a lot of athletes had gone to China and they were credited a bit of ECNY. So they were asked by their governments to use up all this digital asset before they come back to their country. And Bahamas has issued something called Sand Dollar, which is another CBDC. These are the few CBDCs that are in the pipeline. So Singapore Dollar could be coming in a few years, which is something that MAS is working on. They have recently issued a CBDC challenge and they are exploring various models. EU is working on something called a digital euro. I think they have set their target as 2022 for the first version. And they have recently also published a CBDC trend report where they're exploring various models in which the digital euro can be implemented. Back home at India, the Reserve Bank of India, which is India's central bank, has also recently announced that they are experimenting and seeing if they can issue CBDC. And some of the benefits is that CBDCs give you transparency, and as a government, you're delivering benefits. You can ensure last mile delivery of the benefits. The cons for CBDC are there are major privacy concerns. So there are a lot of experts who have come and said that if, let's say, all your currency is issued on a blockchain ledger, the government can know at any point of time how much cash you actually hold in your wallet. And maybe tomorrow they might want to take it back from you, or there could be other concerns as well. So a lot of privacy concerns have been raised by a lot of experts with regards to CBDCs. Second is a secure citizen identity. A lot of governments are also seeing that how they can improve the ID documents or the identity framework that their citizens deal with on a daily basis. So one of the first and one of the most advanced is something called UPort that was implemented in Zug, Switzerland. It started as a proof of residence. It can now be used for voting and accessing various municipal services. EU is building something called ESSIF, the European Self-Sovereign Identity Framework. This is a very interesting model where your identity has various layers or levels to it. So similar to a video game, like a character levels up. In ESSIF, your character also, or your identity levels up. So you start with like a basic level one identity with a public and private key. Then when you do a first level verification with a government issued ID, it goes to level two. Then let's say your education certificates get tagged to your identity and they're notarized by a chancellor of a university, you become a level three. Then with employment, it becomes a level four. So it's a very interesting identity model, which goes beyond just proving your background. Estonia again has something called e-Estonia, using which they give you a digital ID that acts as your citizenship. And then you can also use it for registering a company in Estonia on the KSI blockchain. Some of the interesting use cases with respect to secure citizen identities deals with self-sovereign identities, focusing on immutable consent management. So for example, a lot of governments, especially after the pandemic, are talking about delivering a lot of health schemes and benefits over end-to-end digital workflows. And in such a scenario, consent management and ensuring what data your citizen shared with which medical service provider or with which government entity becomes very important. So in such scenarios, blockchain will play an important role in terms of consent management, because if tomorrow, let's say, someone tries to steal a citizen's data, the only thing that will be in the citizen's favor is an immutable consent management system, which is distributed. And lastly, zero knowledge proof workflows, which can be used for implementing privacy preserving workflows. So just to give an example, a lot of times, such as a hotel or a or an internet cafe or some other service, you have to give them a copy, a paper copy of your government ID, like a passport or something like that. And because of that, a lot of data that you don't want to leak also ends up getting leaked. So a lot of implementations are about myself. So that is where zero knowledge proof workflows will play an important role. Lastly, coming to NFTs and why governments are interested in NFTs. So if you would remember, our presentation started with the topic of ownership of land titles, exchange of land titles. And this had died a slow death. Digitization that needs to happen first to have effective land titles in place. And with NFTs getting popular and people trying to sell NFTs of everything for from like a song to a picture to, let's say, expensive limited edition Rolexes and Pokemon cards, a lot of governments and a lot of technology implementation partners are realizing that a decentralized ledger or public ledger for exchanging assets that require that sort of registration. So, for example, when you talk about land titles, when you talk about vehicle ownership, when you talk about, let's say, arms and ammunition, patents, other government assets, etc. So there's a merit to using a decentralized ledger. And today, when you need to transfer ownership of such items, you still need to go to a government office or an entity registration done. And it's a very cumbersome process typically, because you need to go, you need to prove your identity, and only then the transfer will happen. If, let's say, we are able to do this on a blockchain using a concept similar to NFTs, you could probably theoretically buy and sell land and other such items that require registration using just your smartphone. And you could also do interesting things. So, for example, similar to how with NFTs, people are now exploring royalty and licensing using smart contracts and renting using smart contracts on the blockchain for music or film, etc. You could do the same with patents. You could do the same with other digital assets, such as, you know, certain data that the government has collected, which is, let's say, anonymized, etc., and build interesting revenue models around it. So the scope as far as this topic goes is vast, and this is something that only in the last few months I'm seeing more and more I'll come to an end to my presentation. I can take your questions for now. So my book, Blockchain Development for Finance Projects, is available on Amazon Packpub if you want to know a bit more about how blockchain is implemented in the space of finance. It has 8 interesting projects ranging from payment wallets to payment gateways to decentralized exchanges, etc. Yeah. So if you want, you can check that out on Amazon. And with that, I'll come to a close. And if there are any questions, I can take them. So I see a few questions. Okay, so there's a question from Sri Rajan Rajgopalpan in Tamil Nadu. What is the timeline for specific rollouts? Which startups have any role to play? Is there any plan for... let me take one question at a time. So it says, in Tamil Nadu, what is the time for specific rollout? So we are starting to implement this year. One of the challenges with implementing such a protocol in government is that you need to have a very long-term strategy in place. So a lot of thinking goes into place, a lot of ensuring a lot of compliance requirements are met. Such processes need to be carried out before you can start the implementation. So we'll be starting the implementation this year. Mid of next year, you can probably expect a sandbox for startups to work with the Tamil Nadu blockchain platform. And will startups have any role to play? So yeah, I mean, definitely we plan to provide a sandbox to startups to build applications on top of this platform. The rationale behind this is that when we were drafting our policy, we saw a lot of startups coming and saying that they find it difficult to build a consortium, mostly because for them it's difficult to bring like 10 customers together and build a platform. So if someone can build like a government issued platform, it makes their job easier. So yeah, so definitely startups will have access to an SDK, but obviously you will not have access to citizen data. Probably you will have access to a tech stack. Is there any plan for agriculture supply chain seed to play by the government? Specifically, how can it help improve rural wage inequality and land ownership? So these are all interesting ideas that you are referring to, Sri Rajan. The way we are doing the implementation is that we are doing the implementation in phases. Phase one, we are mostly dealing with digital assets because we need to build a platform that's scalable and can serve all the residents of Tamil Nadu. So this means like digitally issued education certificates, land titles, let's say website data, etc. We are doing some POCs with physical assets like the ones that you are mentioning about agricultural seeds, fertilizers, etc. And also finance will be a topic of concern for us. But these use cases would come further down the line. So maybe 1.5 years from now, once we implement our phase one. Reason being that we want to build a very strong foundation that is sustainable and will last for years to come. So the use cases that you are mentioning will be picked up at that time. Okay. So Sri Rajan, I hope I've answered your question. A few of the other questions I can see in the chat. Okay, so from Sakshi K, speaking from terms of cybersecurity and blockchain, what would be your suggestion where best to read about cybersecurity controls, security framework for blockchain? My assumption would is blockchain would need more regulations like GDPR. So in terms of a specific book or article that you can refer to, I mean, I can't think of anything right now, but if you go to like lexilogy.com, a lot of legal portals and legal websites, they definitely talk about these issues. So lexilogy.com, in fact, has a great breakdown of the PDP bill of 2019 that was created in the parliament and how blockchain is in compliance with that or is not in compliance with that. The EU Blockchain Observatory and Forum also has a great breakdown on what aspects of GDPR blockchain may violate or may not violate. Just in terms of privacy, if you want to explore more, Samsung has an implementation called Next Ledger, I think, where they have done an implementation for an insurance use case, which is compliant with the right to forget tenant of privacy bills. So that is something you might want to explore. Okay, so another question from Kishore. What is your take on e-rupee that has been implemented in India as an emergency fund that is voucher-based? How can we compare this with blockchain network? So as far as I know, e-rupee is only a centralized implementation. How can we compare this with blockchain network? So it's different. It's a centralized network. Blockchain is more of a decentralized implementation. What you could possibly do is you could ensure that last mile delivery is done as desired by capturing audit logs on the blockchain, which can be referred later for reconciliation. So that can be one way of going ahead with e-rupee. For cross-border payments, what's your take on Nexus Gateway, which uses country's Insta payment system rather than deploying blockchain on RTGS side and reconciling on the end of the day? So I'm not aware of Nexus Gateway, but a lot of other service providers provide remittance facility in the same manner. For example, TransferWise or now Wise does that. Western Union also does that. So that's actually an acceptable way of providing a retail remittance service. The problem really comes when you're dealing with the corporate remittances or trade finance, because there you have a lot of compliance steps and regulatory steps that need to be taken care of. And that is really where blockchain plays a big role. In fact, you will not believe it. Even today, a lot of documents that are submitted for reconciliation, clearing LCs, etc., they are still submitted as in paper form. In fact, for that reason, you will see a lot of banks are now forming trade finance consortiums at a domestic level or a global level to solve exactly this problem. So as far as retail remittances go, I think that's a sufficient solution. The problem is mostly with corporate remittances. Hey, yeah, Safaya. So I think I'm done, so we can wrap up. Yeah.
Amazing.
Sorry for going over time.
Oh, no, it's absolutely fine.
Yeah.
We covered a lot of content there, and it was fantastic. So we're going to publish this onto YouTube afterwards. So for those participants that could that signed up and couldn't make the event, we'll also be able to access a recording. And for anyone here that wants to see the talk again, I will publish once it's available on YouTube, I will then send a link into the Slack channel as well. But I just want to say a big massive thank you, Hisham, for coming today and speaking on the track. So
Thank you, Zafar. It was a pleasure. Thank you.
thank you for sharing your knowledge with the community.
Sure, it was a pleasure. Anytime, yeah.